All right, we're going to get started. Lotus Miller is not here yet. Unfortunately, Kim Shuck has had a back spasm problem, and that's really sad. But we have Mary Jean Robinson, and if Mary Jean could come up. And then, is Mr. Natural out there yet? If someone can tell him, he can come through that way. If he's taking the chair, he can come up on the stage this way. And then Bloodflower and Howard Williams. If you guys want to come up to the stage. And I'll always try to read who the next four will be, so you have a warning about that. Okay, and I think Mary Jean's on her way. On her way. That's right. Mary, oh, you're behind me already. I like you. You know how to scare the heck out of me. Mary Jean Robinson has been an activist, God, probably all her life. She's a mainstay at KPOO Radio. She's been an activist forever and someone I have a great deal of respect for. And so here is Mary Jean Robinson.
Hi, I'm really glad I don't have to follow Kim Shuck, because she's really good. And she's also a friend of mine, and she was really upset that she couldn't be here, Dave. However, she did let me have two of her poems to read. So I wanted to share those with you before I started in on Diamond Dave. This one is, Kim Shuck is a poet who was born here in the city. And she is writing some very special city poems. And she wanted to read some of her city poems for Dave Whitaker because it sort of fits, you know? So this one's called Contraband. No need to forbid the songs on a Monday morning with the cold. Shivering the lights near the mint, and the braced gray buildings with their red blinking signals to airplanes. Beware. I think of a fortress as an old-fashioned thing, and in a way it is, but we are not singing, and the barricades are up in some pretense of offense. The boats are in the bay, and the songs are not being sung. Although we are allowed, and revolution is a tee or a jacket and does not lend support, and still the streetlights are trembling as the woman under them does not, and we will measure her worthiness for help, her parents and her choices and the mess, the bold fact of her there. And she isn't singing either, not soup or poems, no songs of any kind. Oh, a mic, it's all right. Not that kind of mic. And then the other poem that she wanted me to share with you is Social Lace. Social Lace. It's smaller, so I have to close it closer. Social lace of drawn threads, the web gone tenuous, a formal tablecloth that we save for best. It's fragile, and it's more fragile with each neighborhood tradition clipped and slowly pulled from the fabric. The stalwarts for birthdays, the sometime weekend visit, the neighbor with the snapdragons, and the fabric gets more fragile and more fragile as we pull each thread. So thank you, Kim Shuck. Now you know why I didn't want to follow her. Yeah, it's her birthday today, so, you know. You're not supposed to get sick on your birthday. I don't know, it's not fair.
It happens.
Okay, so I just wanted to say that I came to the city in 1969. It was a great year to come to the city. I just turned 21, and I don't know, you know, I worked for Ma Bell. It's the time when the phone company was the phone company and nobody else was around. And I also went to San Francisco State. On strike, shut it down. S.I. Hayakawa, go away. And, you know, hell no, we won't go. Yeah, we know all those good old chants and everything else. And, you know, I discovered a lot of little nooks and crannies in San Francisco. And there was a little alleyway on Natoma Street off of 7th Street in the 70s. And it was dark and dangerous and a very interesting place to be. And every once in a while, in all of these places, like over at China Basin, the SLA was having the free food giveaway. And I was working for the phone company over there at China Basin. And San Francisco State was having their ethnic studies. And then I started working at Natoma Street on KPOO radio. So here we go, 89.5 FM. KPOO loves you. You all are our supporters. And we really are a community radio station. And you keep us on the air. It's not anybody else. It's all of you who listen to us. And so every once in a while, everywhere I went, for 20, 30, 40 years, I keep running into this guy who's a little short, and he talks very, very fast. And he keeps talking with his hands. So every once in a while, I feel like channeling this really beautiful, wonderful, wavy gravy kind of, wally-ally kind of, Sufi kind of, you know, all these wonderful people, Monday night class, strange communes, any kind of thing. You'd always find this guy in a red hat or some other weird conglomeration. And you know what? He always told me he was Native. And I always believed him. And he keeps doing that because he is.
My father's
So what I want to say is there is something very, very special about one of the very first rappers before it was popular. Because Diamond Dave can talk a mile a minute, and he still rhymes. You know? I don't know where his brain goes, but it goes into this really wonderful, marvelous, strange space. And I just wanted to thank you all for being here to celebrate Diamond Dave Whitaker Day.
Right on.
And I hope the city still has some spaces that his key is going to open, because I know if there are those places, Diamond Dave will find them.
And that's Mary J. That's Red Voices, KPOO Radio. Such good memories, and the key. The key, the anarchy. And I want to say to the Kim Poem, take down the walls, open the doors, get rid of the borders too. Families, bands, tribes, communities, collectives. I believe in that, but border is just a line on their map. Hey, Richard, take it away.
Well, you see, he still speaks in rhymes. Well, I want to thank Mary Jane for her wonderful reading and stories. First of all, I want to say that if you're going to come up on stage, please come up behind. Dan Brady should be back there and advise you what's next.
I just want to drop it in an occasional line.
You can run around anywhere you want. This is your day, bro.
I want to smoke a little ganja.
Mr. Natural. Mr. Natural is someone that if you don't know, and actually I have found people who don't know who Mr. Natural is. I think that has to be changed. This man has got more information, a mind, he was talking about musical score, and I never heard a man talk about a musical score, the beauty of it, the way it looked on the page. I mean, the man almost was weeping because he loves it so much. So I have a great deal of respect for this guy, and he's here to honor Diamond Dave.
Thank you, everybody. Well, I was born and raised in Chicago, and in 1966, I escaped and came to San Francisco. And in those days, I'm going to try to take you back a little bit. We had this thing we were called beatniks. Do you remember that? And we beatniks ran around, and pretty much we were the precursors to hippies, I guess. Say we were concerned about ecology, civil rights, et cetera, et cetera. But we were also really consumed with the idea of non-ego or existentialism at that particular time. And in 1966, I went to this place called the Spaghetti Factory up in North Beach. And just behind the Spaghetti Factory was a little cafe where a guy by the name of Alan had the One World Family. Alan used to sit there and talk about the old One World Family, right? That we were all Indians, there were no chiefs anymore, that there were no bureaucrats, there were just ordinary people. And that was the philosophy. We all wore Nehru jackets and turtleneck sweaters until they became fashionable. I remember walking down North Beach and looking at tuxedos, and there was a turtleneck sweater, and I said, "Oh my God, the movement's over. We've got to do something else." So I shaved my head and grew a beard. I decided I would do the opposite of what all the other people were doing at that particular time. So I thought, "Well, I'll shave my head and comb my face, right?" Then I went to one of these things. I was going to see Allen Ginsberg and Ferlinghetti, and there in the audience was Dave. And he got up and he was hosting this thing. So I got to meet him and found out that he was going around to the library and various other places and helping poets find spaces to do their thing. And I thought that was revolutionary. And to this day, he's still the number one entrepreneur of poets and wordsmiths in this town. He has gotten more venues and more spaces for us artists to talk about than anybody else. So I'd like to take you back for a moment here and see if I could do three things very quickly. One, I'd like to sing a song that'll go right to your heart about existentialism. And this song is called "What's the Matter with Matter?" Yeah. Well, what's the matter with matter? Here's the matter with matter. You see, it doesn't matter, but it does. Ask any bodhisattva, and they'll tell ya, matter just doesn't matter. But it does. Death dies in a mutter and in a stutter. Everything you just were, everything you just had, becomes a collectivity of debris that a moment ago meant something to somebody. Oh my God, do you think that somebody's me? Maybe it's you. Well, that's the matter with matter. In the long run, it doesn't matter.
But in the short run, you better believe it does, baby. And as I stand up here, attempting to matter, I ask you, what the hell is? What the hell is? Hey, what the hell is going on? I don't know what's going on anymore. I just haven't got a fucking clue. Thank you. And now I went to my diary from June 30th of 1968 and pulled out one of these poems. And this is one of the first poems I read. And it's just simply called Existentialism. Gold fires exploding in my head, lighting the dark labyrinths of my mind. Light cycles moving through the shadowed pages of our two-dimensional consciousnesses, and then Buddha smiles, and a cosmic child kicks the walls of an infinite universe, and in silence, man whispers into that darkness, I am.
No.
And then God closes his eyes to sleep, perhaps to dream of me. Shh.
By mentioning Chicago, you reminded me where I first started out, rode a freight train into Chicago in 1955. And the first place I ever spoke aloud in public was in Buckhouse Square.
Washington Square
in front of the Newberry Library, given by the Newberry Library and the idea that there'd be free speech there forever. Is that my right?
That's right.
And I was given by One-Armed Charlie, who was the dean of the square, this poem. The first time I ever spoke up, I just remember the last line, the last stanza, and it goes like this. You haven't a pot to piss in, or a window to throw you out. Throw it out, but you place your hope in a dago pope that save your iry soul. And that was Buckhouse Square on a soapbox. First time I spoke in public, that was okay, thanks to One-Armed Charlie, who had lost his arm in the Battle of Yips in World War I. So the beat goes on. Okay, thanks for being here, brother. Hear me.
I want to acknowledge the next few people who are coming up. Bloodflower will be next, and Howard Williams, Tim Redman, and then Richard Ivanhoe, so be ready. Diamond, you're going to introduce.
Hey, brother, for sure, I never regard whatever I'm doing incomplete. We've known each other, he says, since 1966. The Poems Under the Dome, which is mentioned, which I know, Poems Under the Dome, which is going to be coming up once again, my 11th annual, the open mic, mother of all open mics in City Hall, always open with a four-direction ceremony by a man I've known since 1966, he tells me. I'm talking about Jorge Molina. Jorge, coming up and give us a four directions. And this is, because that's what we're about. A little ceremony is a good thing.
Now we'll send love, compassion, and understanding to all our brothers and sisters south of us. All those indigenous brothers and sisters who are trying to keep these traditions alive while modern living is encroaching on their territories. Let's send them love, compassion, and understanding to heal what's going on down in South America, the oil industry spoiling the land, poisoning the people, pipelines destroying the planet. They send love, compassion, and understanding. East. Middle East. Children dying, missiles flying. Armament industry making a profit while making a killing. We send love, compassion, and understanding to all our brothers and sisters in the Middle East, our elders that are dying, the children, the women, the destruction. Love, compassion, and understanding. Sisters in prison, the largest growing industry in this country, the prison industry, our brother Leno Peltier, our brother Mumia Bujumal. These people need to be free. Let's send love, compassion, and understanding to the people who are making politics on our behalf to take care of the people. We don't want demagoguery and empty promises. We want the people to work for the people. Love, compassion, and understanding. Each one of you present here, each one of you representing a community, each one of you carrying this power and this love for my friend, Diamond Day, yeah, who has done so much for the communities, the homeless, food not bombs. There's a concept. There's a concept right now, food not bombs. Food not bombs. This is the love for this man. Brother, let me give you a blessing. This is for each one of you.
I'm so glad he had those words to say to us today. Thank you very much. Oh,
yeah.
Your words were good. That's the best I can do. Anyway, the next person who's going to give us his talents is Bloodflower.
Hey, everybody.
Just a short note about Bloodflower. I met him at Mutiny Radio. And
let him talk.
And I find him a fascinating man. He's a talented. He's humorous. He's a good human being. Maybe he doesn't think so, because we all have our dark sides. But I find Bloodflower to be a good, kind man. Yeah. So welcome him.
Wow. Well, thanks. I'll see you later.
Oh, no, we don't do those here.
Oh, no? Okay, good.
We did?
I'm going to play I'll play a little music, and I hope you all dig it. I've known Diamond Dave going on like 2 decades now, from Spoken Word, from Soup Stock, from Common Thread at 21st and Florida Mutiny Radio. Let me see if I can make some noise here.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Peace on all of you. And I want to thank Richard for letting me display my video work up here. Thank you very much. Thank you. Have a good day, everybody. Power to the peaceful.
Thank you, Bloodflower. Give it another round. Did a great job. Thank you, brother. Thank you. While we were earlier, when we were having prayer, the one thing I think we're all sort of neglectful of reminding ourselves and remembering is that we live on a lonely land. So just remember the Ohlone people, that we're here actually at their behest, but you know what the true story is. So if you ever hear that the Ohlone people or the Native people of California need your help, such as maybe the Winneman Wintu when they raise the dam, which you'll probably hear more about, that we, the people out here that I see, who have heart, soul, and intelligence, will remember. Anyway, the next person is Howard Williams. And Howard is a outside of being a pretty, I've only recently really met him, but I like his mind. And Howard is, like I say, a bike messenger. And the reason that's important is because Diamond Dave in 1956 was a bike messenger. So, welcome.
Thank you, Richard. And thank you for saying that I am, and Dave is, a bike messenger. Because messenger is something you don't do and then stop doing. It just keeps on. To sample from a local rapper, hip-hop artist, Priest, you know it don't stop, you know it don't quit, because we stay on that messenger shit. And the profession of messenger has always had a certain edge to it, a certain avant-garde. This goes back to the beginning of the profession, which, because it was before literacy, before writing, the first messengers had to remember their messages. And the best way they could remember was to rhyme. So messengers had a hand in the creation of poetry. And so, though I usually do prose today, in honor of my elder brother, bike messenger, David Diamond Dave Whitaker, and all the messengers who have gone before us, I'm going to do a poem. The name of this poem is revealed in the last five words of the poem. There it stood at the end of the cul-de-sac, basketball backboard, facing the long street that approached it. It's back to the woods. With the sun setting at his back, he bounced the ball, dribbling, never palming. Took a shot, in and out, and in. Retrieved, dribbled a few tricks, behind the knee, trying to be just like Walt Hazard. Left-hand dribble, 360, right-hand shot, in and out. Whispered curse. Twirled the ball on his fingertip. Remembered the day he helped his dad build this backboard. Remembered Pop's rule, can't miss the last one. Taught the kids that same rule. On this same backboard, after 9/11, could not convince them to stay away from the army. Both kids went to Iraq. One came back. She went to college, became a doctor. She and her husband gave their parents two grandkids so far away. Dad, she said, a young family can't afford to live here anymore. Took a shot, in and out. The sun was setting. Another shot, off the rim. Darker. Can't miss. Another shot. The last one. A brick. Only stars and one flickering streetlight. Another thought of her. Swish. Can't miss the last one. I have to apologize that I have to leave early, but thanks to Diamond Dave and many of you out there, we still have City College, and so I got to get to class.
Give it up again. All right. Tim Redman. There he comes. Does anybody know, not know Tim Redman? Does anyone here not know? Raise your hand. Well, I don't have to say anything about him then, huh? Well, I'm going to let him have the whole time because he's got some news for us, too.
Hey. Thank you all. Thank you all for coming to celebrate my old friend Diamond D. The news I have for you, which some of you already know, the Bay Guardian shut down about a year after I was summarily dismissed in the middle of the night for not getting along with the new owner. But we have reacquired the rights to the Bay Guardian. We have raised enough money to begin the resurrection of the Bay Guardian, thanks to many of you here. And we will not be putting out a weekly newspaper in print unless somebody here has like $10 million for me. Anyone? Yeah. But we will be doing it on the web, and we will be doing Guardian endorsements in the spring so we can help people understand what the issues are and how to vote. That's enough about me. I came here, actually, to talk about Dave. You know, it's not a great time for the counterculture in San Francisco. In fact, it's not a great time for anyone in San Francisco right now who isn't rich, white, a landlord, a speculator, a developer, or someone who makes a lot of money in the tech industry. The rest of us often feel kind of cast to the side. And it's easy to get depressed. I live in Bernal Heights. I ride my bike along Valencia Street. And I think about what Valencia Street was like when I moved to the city in 1981. And I think about all the people and all the places that are gone. And in fact, I find myself, I can't even make it down the bike lane on Valencia anymore because it's clogged with Ubers, letting rich white people out to go to the fancy restaurants that I can't afford to go to on Valencia Street. And you know, it's easy to just say, oh, you know, that's the hell with it, it's over, we've lost. And then I run into Diamond Dave. And Diamond Dave is always a reminder to me that San Francisco is still here, that it's still out there, the San Francisco that so many of us came here for, that some of us were born into, that I came here as a, you know, white kid from the suburbs, from the white bread suburbs in New York, thinking I've got to get the hell out of here and go someplace where people are different. And I arrived in San Francisco for people like, to see people, to meet people like Diamond D. And every time I run into him and we talk and he says, don't panic, keep it organic, I think we're still here. We're still here, San Francisco. So I've known Diamond Dave for a long time. We've gone through a lot of things together. The Bay Guardian gave him an award for his poetry work. And in fact, what I realized when I was thinking about this is Dave is at a lot of protests. He and I have shared a lot of demonstrations at City College of late, where I teach, and he is a continual student because Dave is a lifelong student of life and never stops learning. And what I thought about is, you know, Dave is actually an organizer. Not in the way that a lot of people think about political organizers. Dave is a cultural organizer. And he has really done more. And when we wrote about him in The Guardian these years back, we thought, you know, Dave has really done more than a lot of people to organize culture in the city, to find places, as has been talked about for poets, to encourage people to get out there the way political organizers go out there and say, you gotta come out tomorrow and you gotta vote, you gotta do this, you gotta go to this meeting. Dave is out there saying, you gotta come listen to Poems Under the Dome. You gotta make room for poets in the city. And for that, we will always appreciate him. We'll also always appreciate him for things like one of my favorite stories, and I'll end on this. Diamond Dave and me were at City Hall about 5 years ago. Some of you know the story when the city honored another rebel poet named John Ross. And after the, you know, they gave the ceremony and John gave a speech about how horrible San Francisco politics was and denounced all of the supervisors and denounced capitalism. And then Dave and me and John and a few others were supposed to go to a reception in Supervisor Avalos' office, but the food hadn't arrived and they weren't ready. So they sent us down to that conference room around the corner. Some of you have been to City Hall, there's the Board of Supervisors. You go all the way down around the corner and there's a conference room, and they sent us down there to wait. And of course, it being 4:20, Diamond D looked around and said, "Hey guys, it's 4:20. And he opened a window and he lit up. And so did everybody else in the room. And the pot smoke starts billowing out the room of the conference room at City Hall and rolling down the hall. And before long, you can smell it in the Board of Supervisors chamber. You can smell it everywhere. And you know, Dave and John and the guys are happily enjoying themselves. And somebody in the Board of Supervisors chamber got wind of this, so to speak, and informed the sheriff. So here we are, me and Diamond D and John Ross and QR Hand and a bunch of other rebel writers and poets. And into the room comes two deputy sheriffs. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, now we're all going to get arrested. And once again, you know, we're not going to go peacefully. And it's going to be a mess. And this is going to be a god-awful thing. And I remember the younger female deputy sheriff looked directly at Diamond D and said, "I'm sorry, folks, but this is a non-smoking building." And we were rescued from the police that time, and Diamond D had poems under the dome that night, and we all lived to go forward, which is what we're all doing. And thanks to Diamond D for reminding us that we all live to move forward. Thank you, my friend. Thank you for
having me. The past shakes hands with the future, the now. What I remember is walking in and saying, "Oh, no," and hearing John Ross's son on the phone saying, "Guess what? My dad is smoking weed in the city hall." And I go, "Oh, no." And I said, "What is 420? "You go to the balcony, go to those balconies." And then the deputy came in smiling and said, "No, this is all right. No smoking here, please." And that was 6 years ago, so the statute of limitations has run out. And I was afraid that when John Avalos heard about it, it would be end of any commendation, any key to the city, because the key to the city is an anarchy, and I know that, but here we are. Hey, thanks, Tim. Who do you got next?
We got Richard Ivanhoe.
Richard Ivanhoe, Richard and I, coming up, Richard. Richard inherited on the page, off the page, an open mic, which we did for a long, long time, and he still does at the Park Branch Library up in the Haight on Page Street. Hey, Richard.
Sorry to interrupt. Rainbow and Drift, you're up. So if you gotta get it tuned up. And then it's Calvin Welch. Then it's Judy Levy and Ramon Sender, some of my favorite people. All right.
So, knowing that I'm following Tim, I wanted to do something a little different. Along some of those lines, I do have a poem about gentrification. You can ask me about that later. Right now, this one's called Legend. Legends come from what we've experienced, what we've read, and what we've heard. Maybe you'll find some of each in this string of words. Rexroth, Kerouac, Dylan, Ferlinghetti, Common Thread, Rainbow Family, Diggers, Rock and Roll Spaghetti, Cast a Wide Net, Homes Under the Dome, Food Not Bombs, Pirate Cat, Blabbermouth Night, Viracocha, District Elections, Save CCSF, and still more than that. On the page, off the page, Occupy San Francisco, Vice President of Cultural Affairs, Black Man's Free Store, Dinky Town, Revolution Cafe, Bound for Glory. Wait, there's still more. Hanging in, hanging out, hanging around, Enemy Combatant Radio. We can do more together than we can do on our own. Free University of San Francisco. Between the Lines of the New York Times, Jack's Pool Hall, History, Herstory, Hipstery, Mutiny Radio, Beatniks, Hippies, Punks, Hip Hoppers, 1% Free Returns to the Community. I'm sure I missed something, and you're still catching on to that next wave. So thank you, local legend, local hero, Diamond Dave, and always remember, don't panic.
Keep it organic.
Keep it organic.
Did anybody hear that line in a movie recently?
Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Oh, okay. Well, I was... Sometimes I have a, I do have a TV. I mostly use it for background, but Robert De Niro was using the line. I said, "Oh my God!" Well, anyway, it's Calvin Welsh here. You're going to be after this gentleman here, so if you want to come on up. All right. So. Yes.
Okay.
I want to say something about Rainbow and Drift. Again, part of the Common Thread Collective. And when you hear his stuff, it will take you where you need to be. Very, very, very gentle soul. And the true meaning of what I think a hippie was and is.
Thank you.
Not was in his case, and referring back to when it was. And I think he's... another great guy, and Drift adds to his music, and
it takes one to know.
Too. He's also a poet. He writes his stuff. So
okay. This is Drift on Rainbow. This is a song that was influenced by the Grateful Dead's "Turn on Your Love Light." It's called "If Love Is a Light, Let It Turn You On." Baby, I love you with a love that is true. There's a correlation between pleasure and pain. It feels so good, but it hurts so bad. I wake up glad, but I retire sad. You know I'll even kiss the earth you walk upon. Yeah, I'll even kiss the earth you walk upon. You know I'll even kiss the earth you walk upon. Yeah, I'll even kiss the earth you walk upon. If love is a light, let it turn you on. If love is a light, let it turn you on. If love is a light, let it turn you on. You got the kind of wisdom really blows my mind. And your lips are like strawberry wine. Well, if I promise to make you smile.
Kind of days, all right, my book.
Thank you. All right, the next person up is Calvin Welsh. And does anyone here not know Calvin Welsh? Oh, see, it's an easy introduce.
Forty-five years ago, I met David Allen Whitaker in a class that I was teaching at USF, and David was my student. Over the 45 years, I have continued to attend the University of Whitaker here in San Francisco. I worked in a community-based organization for a number of years, 409 House in the Haight-Ashbury. And one of the projects that we became involved with was creating a community radio station out of KPOO. And a phone call came one afternoon asking if somebody could do a political program, kind of a commentary program, and none of us really wanted to do it. And David said, I can do it. I can do it. And anybody who has lived in San Francisco over the last 45 years and has a love affair with the spoken word and the radio will have heard David over those years, sometimes very loudly, sometimes very faintly. And in many ways, there are two audible tracks of San Francisco, its politics and its culture over the last 45 years. And one is Krasny on KQED, and the other is David Allen Whitaker. And whereas Krasny has never met a polysyllabic word that he doesn't embrace and give a wet kiss on the lips to, David has never met a multifaceted community-based organization or movement that he has not embraced, but more than embraced, sold to everybody who he can find that will listen. David Whitaker is the most well-read, the most articulate, the most incredibly creative political bumblebee that the city has ever known. He has put people together who didn't even know that they were supposed to be together and didn't realize it for a decade or so. David goes beyond perception. David feels it. David, we are all in your movie. We are all the notes of your songs. We are all the words of your poems. And thank you for sharing this city and your life with us all. Thanks.
Calvin, as you have 45 years, that's a good long time. I want to mention the connection with the Good Earth Commune, because they're no longer gone, but there we were after the death of the hippie, when we stuck around, and all my kids were growing up, and we were doing it, and through the Good Earth, I had access, I could say it now because the statute of limitations is far, far gone, to good old ounces of good ganja for only $10 an ounce back in those good old days when it didn't get in the way of what you did. And enhanced what you did. So Calvin brought all that back to me too, and here we are still carrying on. And I'm so glad to be here. And going back to the first district elections, Harvey Milk in the first district elections, Calvin, the first community Congress, time to do another one. Thanks, Calvin, for coming on through. And everybody for being right here. It's about the midpoint, I think, of this evening. And here we be. So thanks for coming, brothers and sisters. Hey, Richard. And this Richard is doing this. Take it away, Richard.
The next two people who are coming up were the ones who were the first ones that let me read publicly.
so I have always got a soft spot. And when they saw, when I read a, or I said a piece, what I wrote, they were, I think, impressed, and that's why they asked me. So I want to thank you for that. And I'm glad to see that they've made it, is Judith Levy and Ramon Sender.
I share political affinity, love City College, save City College. It's not over yet. We're still working on it. So thank you, Dave, because you're a touchstone. Whenever I go to a demonstration and Dave is there, I feel very happy, very reassured. This is a found poem for an octogenarian, would you believe? He's an octogenarian. 78. Well, my husband is 81, and I'm always, you know, respectful. So we're looking forward, not backwards. Dinky Town, Minneapolis. Diamond in the rough. A rose is a rose is a rose, no pose. Our connection, Wendy. John Roses, my aunt's nephew. What a whirl of a world, and you, once bike messenger, message foods, not bombs, in myth, in reality, inhabitant of paradise for cats with nine children or none. The whole world is your child. Golden floor. Ground floor of Occupy, where once Bob Dylan crashed, you are pioneer radioologist who writes, performs poems under, below, above the domes. Dave Whitaker, carer, carrier of wit, giver, not taker, rad raconteur, rab rouser, real deal here since Nation article in 55. Always with City College demonstrations, you who so widely cast a net, find a common thread, spread the word. We can do more together than apart. Don't panic, keep it organic. Organize every day, summer of love. Long may you flourish.
Thank you, David. I didn't hear a word. No, my ears are terrible. That's what it is. Anyway, I was involved with the TRIPS Festival 50 years ago now. And after it, I thought, well, that's a good idea. Maybe I'll take a trip. So I went off to the desert and visited the only commune I knew at the time, which was Drop City in Colorado, and came back, looked up my new friend Lou Gottlieb from the Limelighters, who had told me before I left, hey, you know, if you ever want to do anything in the country, I've got 30 acres up in Sonoma County. So we went up apple blossom time, and I said, I'm staying, and I stayed. And some friends came up, and they said, oh, we're staying. And friends of theirs came up and said, we're staying. So about 6 months later, the San Francisco Diggers came up and said, hey, Lou, if we planted a garden and took care of the orchard, could we have all the food to feed everybody? And Lou said, why not? So we went from 12 people to 80 people over a period of weeks. And the county began to show some interest. anyway, be that all that as it may, it was an interesting experience. A lot of people got busted and told either you're going to do time in jail or you're going to leave the county. So a lot of them left the county and and spread the message of land access to which is denied no one.
And by the way, we talk a lot about homelessness, but homelessness is really a cover for landlessness. And if we were all in Central America or South America, we'd know immediately what that means, because it's the lack of land ownership that's screwing everything up, I think, or a big part of it. Anyway, Morningstar Ranch, we had everybody. We had the gurus, the saints, the bodhisattvas, the down and outers, the people who just couldn't make it on the street. We had people addicted to alcohol, and the alcohol thing was so heavy that we said, well, maybe if we put 10 tabs of white lightning in that gallon of Magic Mountain, or whatever it was called, maybe that would help. Well, it didn't help. So ever since then, and I've gotten involved in various other things, but in the back of my mind was, isn't there something out there that can handle that empty feeling in the pit of my stomach that seems to bring people to the bottle? And so I've spent a lot of years thinking about it, trying out different things. I learned how to purr from my cats. And that helped a lot. That really does dissolve that feeling. But I finally settled on something that all babies do called sleep nursing. And that is they nurse while they're sleeping. And adoring parents make videos of these and put them up on YouTube. So if you want to see baby sleep nursing, look up sleep nursing on YouTube and you can have many examples. Well, I figured if babies do it, it must feel good. So maybe I can do it, and instead of doing it asleep, I'm going to do it awake. So I taught myself how to sleep nurse. It's sort of like sucking on your uvula. If you don't know what your uvula is, it's behind your soft palate. But after I did all this work and I wrote it all up, I thought, you know, just go out and buy a lollipop. And so I guess that's my ultimate message for everyone, is if you want to dissolve the hollow feeling in the pit of your stomach, keep a good supply of lollipops around.
Come on, Sender, to cut to the chase. Hey, Ramon, it reminds me I should let people know that I now have 15 years of sobriety. That means without a drink. And they came to my Native American side, hey, Mary Jean, called the Red Road. I used to say, I go to AA meeting, it makes me want to drink. I go to a comedy night, it makes me want to cry. But then I heard the Red Road, this is from Lakota. And the Red Road is the warrior path, the sober path, and its prayer is, Great Spirit, whose voice I hear in the wind, whose breath gives life to the world, hear me. I come to you as one of your many children. I'm small and weak, I need your strength and wisdom. May I walk in beauty. It's also called the Beauty Way. That's the Red Road. And what you remember, when you mentioned Lou Gottlieb, that took me back to another pivotal moment I hadn't mentioned, where I'm walking, I think, on Haight Street, and I see coming towards me, a guy looking around like this, and I said, my God, this guy looks like your classic Indian guru. We knew about Maharishi, and this guy was lost on Haight Street. What was his name? He was Lou Gottlieb's guru. He was lost. Yes, Shiradeva came out in the airport. Lou Gottlieb was supposed to pick him up, but they missed each other. And then he came to Haight Street, because that's all he knew. And I believe I brought him to Hippie Hill, where they connected, and that's where the family began. And that's what you're talking about. The family, and at High Point, they had a bunch of houses right there off Haight Street on what street?
Cole.
On Cole Street. No, it was farther down on Cole. I was on this side of Divisadero.
They had five houses.
Exactly, all these houses, but they're around that Sheridiva. So that's the two things that you brought me back. And it was Ramon Sender's father, Ramon Sender, who really turned me on when I was a social anarchist, a youth at 16 or so, and I found your father's book, Seven Red Sundays, about this anarchist revolt in Barcelona, am I right? And his book called Counterattack in Spain, about being an anarchist militia in Barcelona at the same time as George Orwell wrote Homage to Catalonia, am I right? And then I finally meet you, and I say, I knew about your dad, and now I'm seeing you in the flesh. And he's an old guy now, too, so life goes on. That's what I have to say to you. Thanks, Jim. Thanks for coming, you two. Elders, elders.
All right. Hal Robbins. I'm lucky enough to hear this man's stuff, his own stuff. But he also renders a lot of people's poets who've passed. He's got it all committed, and a great, just a great speaker. And so far as I can tell, a pretty well-around man, I guess is what you would say. So Hal, thanks for coming, and give it.
Thank you. I was once on Pirate Cat Radio, where Dave is now, as it's a Mutiny Radio, and moved briefly to FCC Free Radio, and that didn't work out, and ended up here, ended up at Radio Valencia. Anyway, I'm going to say a poem about a despised creature, which actually is a necessary one in a spirit of charity, which is the spirit that Dave inspired. This is a poem by American poet David Bottoms called Under the Vulture Tree. We have all seen them circling pastures, have looked up from the mouth of a barn, the fences of our own backyards, and have stood amazed by the one slow wing beat, the endless dihedral drift. But I had never seen so many, so close, hundreds, every limb of the dead oak feathered black. And I cut the engine, let the river grab the John boat and pull it toward the tree. The black leaves shined, the pink fruit blossomed, red, ugly as a human heart. Then, as I passed under their dream, I saw for the first time its soft countenance, the raw, fleshy jowls, wrinkled and generous, like the faces of the very old who have grown to empathize with everything. And I drifted away from them, slow on the pull of the river, reluctant, looking back at their roost, calling them what I never called them, what they are, those dwarfed, transfiguring angels that flock to the side of the poisoned fox, the mud turtle crushed on the shoulder of the road, who pray over the leaf graves of the anonymous lost with mercy enough to consume us all and give us wings. Thank you, Dave.
Well, I never speak that clearly. Let's see here. God, get lost. Allison B., you're up. Is D. Allen here?
D. Allen, where's D?
Where's D?
Where's D? Karen, do you want to wait a little bit? Or do you just... I'm sorry. You got him? Ask him if he wants to wait one. So he catches... Do you want to come on up now? All right. Well, I just thought I'd give him a little breath. All right, there you go. I am so glad. I can't tell you how glad I am that Jose Cuellar is here. That's right. This is a man that we also here in the city need to recognize. If you've not come to the mission or ever heard his music or heard how he thinks or knows the depth or hears the depth of the knowledge of music, this is the man. So give it up for Jose Cuellar.
Thank you so much, Richard. Thank you all my relations. I really appreciate this opportunity to pay tribute to a dear friend, someone who's been in the struggle, and someone who got ripped off a number of times. But have you noticed that that dirty grandpa ripped off Don't Panic, Keep It Organic? Beautiful. They ripped him off. That's right. So, thank you for everything you've done, David. Really love you, really appreciate you. And I'd like to play this inspiration on this little flute that I acquired a couple of years back at the Stanford Powwow, made by Oaxacan Nash Tevawa. And an inspiration for you, Diamond Dave.
Is that, hey, Dr. Loco, hey, Jose, nothing that comes through me belongs to me. The understanding I have with the cosmos is that that which comes through me, there's no copyrights. That which comes through me is just to come through me. Like my latest, when I about to turn 78, it came through me. Learn to love, love to learn. This never ends. That if it's to come through me, it's well, anybody's welcome to it. If I try to copyright it or say it's mine or ripped it off, no. Anything that comes through me belongs to everybody. That's the guarantee it will keep on coming as long as I'm here on the planet. Oh, yeah. We got Barbara here, too.
We had to get the confirmation on something here.
We got to try to... Campio is here too, so we got it.
Yeah. Okay. And we're going to let Karen Melander Magoon come up. And then is Susanna Wedgwood here? Susanna? If you want to get ready or come up to the stage. So, and then next person's. E.K.,
yes.
If you want to come up to the stage.
And a minor announcement now?
The restrooms downstairs are unusable. So you have to go upstairs. So I'm sorry about that. Anyway. Yeah. Yeah, but you have to go upstairs now because this down here is closed.
Oh.
They're not working.
Oh my goodness, that's important. That was an important announcement. Yes.
honored to be here at the University of David Allen Whitaker. The university, the synagogue, the temple, the city. Celebrating Diamond Dave, activist, poet, co-creator, since 1957, is that right? Or anyway, maybe before that, part of San Francisco's life from beginning and end, creator of Poems Under the Dome, co-creator of San Francisco history. What an honor just to be here. About Dave, and thank you for your raps, your rhymes, your egalitarian philosophy. Thank you for Poems Under the Dome. Thanks for being a legend, and I never heard that before, but thank you for being a political bumblebee. And I have seen this bumblebee at lots of demonstrations and always wondered how you could be so many places. Say the name of Dave. He can't be easily pigeonholed, always inventing, finding new perspectives, larger than life. Only you must listen carefully so you don't miss the words. Notice he spends more time talking about others than himself. An extraordinary poet speaking the poetry of mindfulness. Don't panic, keep it organic. And since I do have another couple seconds, yes, here's to Dave. Yay. It seemed appropriate just to talk about time. Time has no time, it ticks endlessly into bells pealing, air waving with fingers of God, finding time irrelevant, non-existent. A construct of the imagination, imaging time. Time has no space. It flows endlessly into orchestras of sound, into orchestras of sunsets, smells, and tastes, revolving and inventing time before their time. Lethargy of growing old, juvenile birds remind one of eternity and youth, energy, joy. Children die in war, dying before their time, and I cannot give them my life, my time. I cannot wake them back into their youth, energy and joy. I cannot make life from their deaths, cannot give them back time. And yet today, we see Dave Diamond, who gives us all time, energy, and hope. Thank you, Dave.
Hey, Richard, I'm going on without you, because here I go. We have Richard Sanderill here, and he put this together today with Dan Brady. Let's offer a little love and gratitude for our fearless organizers. As a fearless organizer myself, I know that these things are never easy or simple, and it's been an ongoing honor since year one of Poems Under the Dome to organize it with Diamond Dave, and currently with Val. There she is there. Yay to them too. So I'm regularly inspired by this question that Dave asks. What's wrong with a little peace, love, and understanding? So here's three poems, mostly about love. Tattoo. Do you have a tattoo? Who here has pierced ears? What have you done for love and lost? Once, there was a little known goddess of war, and she was in love with the king of the gods, and he loved her, but she didn't know he was the secret love of the goddess of love. So she asks a jealous friend for advice. The love goddess snorts and says, "To prove your love, cut off your ear and give it to him." So she mutilates her body to make herself more attractive to her lover. And he's so horrified, so disgusted, he turns his face from her kiss. And the truth is, scars are beautiful. Secretly, we all know it's our imperfections that attract us to one another. There's nothing more beautiful than a crooked nose, tooth, finger, or toe. And like a little-known goddess of war, we wonder who it will be who will look at our scars and love us. Narcissism. The shadow of the Lorax plays on the walls of Plato's cave, where Christ was buried, and on the third day, Sisyphus rolled the rock away and invented religion to fuel old feuds with folks who might yet be friends. The world is small and getting smaller, an unlikely oasis in space. I am you. All the myths are true. And of course, we see ourselves reflected in every drop of water. It is us. And here's number three. Where's Dave? Where'd he go? There he is. Outrageous beauty. Outraged by noses that aren't small or straight, by hair that doesn't lay flat, by faces whose features refuse to conform to a common standard of beauty. They tell us we are ugly. To defend their common features, they sell us funhouse reflections so we don't know what we look like. I want to convert you to the religion of your own outrageous beauty. I'll build you a church of mirrors and fill it with gods like us, whose faces don't match. Thanks, Dave.
Yes, give it up for EK. Absolutely. All right, let me go down my list. Oh yes, we have Allison B. And I'll just leave it at that because I think the shorter the better. We've been doing stuff.
That's
yeah,
right.
If or you can use the other one.
This is good. Yeah, this is my height.
One more thing. I want to see the next people are here. Susanna Wedgwood. All right, if you're here, come on up. And then we have. Looks like Valerie Ibarra. Oh, wait a minute. Somehow this got mixed up. Susanna Wedgwood, did she do it? She did it, right?
Yeah.
Oh, well, yeah. Did I miss you, too?
No, we just...
Was I in the right order? Okay. Sorry. I just want to make sure I'm doing it right.
That's okay, Richard. I think you're still trying to not panic.
Yeah, I think so.
Good. I'll try not to panic up here. I breathe a sigh of relief when Dave comes into my library about once every other month and says, "Hey, Allison, how's it going?" And one time my manager recognized him and she let us put it on our office door. Thank you, Dave. And he knows what I mean. He's a breath of fresh air. He likes poetry, and he's poetic. He's a storyteller, impresario, and very well-known humanitarian. I made that up. It means that he invites community, and he promotes it, and he reminds us that his goal is our goal, always working for the common good. He's also kind of catchy, in tune, and avant-garde. He helps get us back in place when we seem confused. He sets us in the right direction. He has a good word for everyone. He's somewhat analytical, but mostly optimistic. To me, he is a mystic sometimes. He looks around the room and reminds us, take a moment to breathe. It's always a place to create. And then he reminds us to share our hearts with each other and take care of each other. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you, Susan B. I just met Susanna Wedgwood, so I really can't say much, but she seems like a nice person, and I have to say that. So, welcome, Susan.
Thank you. Hello. My name is Susanna, and I grew up in San Francisco. I've known Dave for a long time. I've been away from the city for a really long time, but when I heard that this was Diamond Dave Day, I had to get here and say a few things. What I'd like to do is just share with you some stories and memories that I remember from my childhood. I've tried not to write it down or think too hard about it, but I would like to just share with you a stream of consciousness, memories of my childhood and what I remember about Dave Whitaker. My family moved to San Francisco in 1971. We lived in the Haight-Ashbury. We settled in Hayes Valley, and we had a little place on Hayes Street, across the street from what is now the sacred ground. I went to school in a little hippie alternative school. And my mother, Johanna, she had a job working in the coffee house on Hayes Street. And when I first met Dave Whitaker, it was around 1974, 1975, when this little hippie alternative school that was run by some hippies and Rastafarians, that somehow they got a grant and they started this school. And they were able to get a second facility down on Haight Fillmore in a church where they ran a daycare center. They had a school bus, and they took children, a busload of children, out of Geneva Towers over in Hunters Point and brought them to the daycare center at Haight Fillmore, and they would take all the little kids on field trips. And anyway, right next door to the church, there was a family. They lived in a storefront, and there was a man, his name was Dave Whitaker, and his wife, and I believe her name was Beverly. I'm not sure that's right. That's what I remember. And I remember that Beverly wore a different wig every day, and she was very flamboyant. I remember hanging out in that storefront with them because they had 9 children. And the children that were around my age, we played together. Ooby Dooby, Opal, no, I'm sorry.
Sapphire.
Sapphire. and joy. And I haven't seen Ubi Dubi in over 30 years, and I was hoping to see him here today. He had to work today. But in any case, he's my Facebook friend, so, you know, we're still connected somehow. And what I remember about Dave Whitaker was that he seemed to me like he was a straight guy. So, you know, I lived in the hate with hippies, and Dave Whitaker, when I met him, had a short haircut and a suit. And I think maybe he was going to a job interview at that time, and that was where it was. Moving on, though, a few years later, I was a teenager, and Dave was good friends with my mother, Johanna Wedgwood, and I got to run with my mother on a lot of trips. We went to poetry readings and musical events and places all around the city, North Beach, the Hate. But there was a whole new scene that was starting up in the Mission around that time, 1980-81 time frame. And there were poetry readings in places. I'll just name some of the events that maybe you'll remember them. There was the Vats at the Old Hams Brewery. There was the Punk Rock. And when I was 14, I had a job working in this music studio at the Vats. And there was the Compound, which was a very exciting place to hang out on 16th at this old fire station that was turned into a sort of an art collective. Project Arto, thank you. There were many events and many things there. I remember going to the old spaghetti factory and going to the flamenco dance night. And thank you. There's many things I've forgotten as well, but what I remember, though, was that there was a place on 22nd in Valencia where there was an art studio called The Offensive.
The Offensive, I love that.
And yes, thank you. There were a lot of great parties there, a lot of art events, galleries. Dave organized poetry readings there. And I just wanted to tell a quick anecdote about one time I went to the poetry reading with my mom, and, you know, Dave, he was kind of a hippie, an old hippie at the time. He was old. He was like 45. And when I was 14, it was my goal in life to just go out and raise hell. And I had my head shaved, and I ran around with black nail polish. And I had a hobby of giving people free haircuts. And I went into the poetry reading one night at The Offensive, and I offered people free haircuts. And Dave Whitaker, he said, "Oh, I need a haircut." And do you remember this?
I'm coming back now.
And so it turned into a kind of performance art haircut where he was in the middle of a room and there was a circle of people and I was giving him this haircut. And I thought, okay, this old hippie, I'm gonna blow his fucking mind. And I gave him a crew cut. And then on the back of his head, I kind of left some long bits and put in some bald things. And I was pretty pleased that I could, you know, do that. And anyway, Dave took it in stride, and Dave was cool. And Dave, he understood what the kids were doing, you know. And so then the last I really remember seeing him, he hung out with my mom. That was part of her scene, you know. I was just in and out of it.
She was a witch. A good witch.
She was a good witch. And the last I remember seeing Dave was walking down the street with a motorcycle jacket and with chains and safety pins.
No chains.
Okay, safety pins, beatnik, hippie, hippies, punk.
Punks, skins, a three-generation rainbow.
And so. I thought, right on, you know, he's one of us. I left the city in the 90s. I did not see Dave or anybody really for many years. And I came back for an event in 2010 at the Sacred Grounds poetry reading. And I remember that night that I didn't really know anybody. I mean, there was still a lively poetry scene and there's this community of people. But when Dave Whitaker walked in the door, I just thought, oh, how wonderful. He's still alive. And he was alive and well. And now I know that he's done his a lot of activism. He's still very active in the community. He has his radio show. I'm really so happy that he is still walking this earth and that he is still on the street connecting with people and that there's still this community, which I thought was ancient history. But there are remnants of that. And it goes on. And I don't know what's going on with Dave's hair now. But I don't think it really matters anymore because Dave Whitaker has transcended the beatnik hippie punk paradigm because he is a star. And he is like a shining diamond in the sky. And he's still here, and he's still doing it. And so I'm so happy and so glad to know that you're here. So happy birthday.
Punk rock street. We had the Offensive in 1981. The Tool and Die up the street, remember? Oh. And then Bread at 16, so it was a death club. It was a real death club. The deaf people like punk rock. Okay, we better keep moving. Well, how much time do we have?
Oh, we have time.
We have time.
We
got Carol Campbell here in any way.
Yes, well, they're going to be the closers. Good. So. Who said that?
Yeah, I know the clock. That's a big responsibility.
All right. So, the next person who has come up to our stage. Wow. Who do you think that was? I wonder who did that. I wonder who just whistled her. Anyway, glad to see you. I want to say I'm so glad this person is here because, wow, she controls that show more. I mean, Dave does the talking, but she's got control. And I think it's a beautiful collaboration myself, but, you know, who am I? But and as I say, I'm really glad she's here. I think she's a strong voice on the radio for women, from what I've observed. So, number one, I'm glad that's going on. And not to belabor it, but welcome Valerie Ibarra.
All right. It's not about control, it's about patience, persistence, and positivity.
Yeah.
So I'm a native San Franciscan, and I'm a poet. And I've been writing poetry since I was about 12, but it wasn't until I was in my 20s when I realized I hadn't ever really read my poetry for anybody. And so I had this idea, and I was thinking about it, and then I was on a bus. That's how many of my stories begin. I was on a bus, and I overheard some people talking about a poetry reading at the Page Street Library in the Hate, hosted by Diamond Dave, who I didn't know at the time. So I kind of made a mental note. I'm like, the Hate, it's like my backyard. Perfect. I'll do that sometime. And I didn't go. And then another time I was on a bus, and I met Diamond Dave. And he invited me down to the On the Page, Off the Page, which Richard is now hosting. So that was my first time I ever read poetry in public in San Francisco. while I was there, Dave invited me down to his show, which at the time was at Pirate Cat Radio, still the Common Thread Collective, which we're doing every week at Mutiny Radio. What we used to do is the opening of the show was to read between the lines of the New York Times. So I would go once in a while, go for the first 20 minutes of the show, read between the lines of the New York Times, and leave. But then it was 2010, everything's changed, and I started going more regularly, and I could just feel that the momentum was building. So for my New Year's resolution, which I've never made one for since, for 2011, was I'm going to go every week. And I started going every week, and within a couple months, I knew how to run the boards, and I was co-hosting the show, and Dave and I have been working together ever since. So being part of Mutiny Radio, and thanks to Dave for bringing me into this, it's opened many doors for me. A couple years after I started, I got recruited by KPFA to do Women's Magazine, which is a weekly show, but I contribute to it periodically. It's Mondays 1 to 2 at KPFA 94.1. And so I started doing my weekly show at Mutiny Radio, Women's Magazine with Global Val. So I get to do that every Friday before the Common Thread Collective. I got a 3-page spread in my high school alumni magazine. I grew up here, I went to SI. So that was a pretty prestigious move because it was countercultural in an otherwise rather kind of straight magazine. I also started helping EK with Poems Under the Dome. And then one day I was sitting there live on air and I met and vetted my brilliant love over there, the remarkable Renaissance man and poet James Zellis, who himself had never performed in public before Diamond Dave had asked him to do so at some other venue. But being the co-host and producer of Common Thread Collective has immersed me in a whole new community. It's not just reading the news, but making the news. We've been the real-time platform for the Arab Spring, Occupy Wall Street West, Occupy Hurricane Sandy, the 2012 Republican National Convention protests where Dave was down there calling in, Hands Up, Don't Shoot, 1 Billion Rising, No to the XL Pipeline, No Monster in the Mission, Save CCSF, Vote 123, Yes in My Backyard, and we were there the day that the UN Indigenous Peoples Charter was signed last June, and it came into our studio. And we've been warmed and inspired by countless musicians, and poets, authors, activists, travelers, and we must be striking a chord because in the last 2 years alone, we've had almost 200,000 downloads. Who knew? So it's a privilege and a joy to be proponents of free speech, freedom of peaceful assembly, while also pursuing happiness and a more evolved humanity based on love and acceptance and positivity. As Diamond Dave says, thinking outside the box and pushing the envelope, and we're doing that every Friday at mutinyradio.fm. You're free to join us at 21st in Florida. Please come through. And as a final little poetic note, this is Groundhog Day, and I thought it was symbolically appropriate because the groundhog, we look to the groundhog, right? To give us the signal, what's coming next? And Dave's like that. So I want to end with a little excerpt from a poem I wrote 2 years ago. I was recovering from a surgery and having wild healing dreams, and they kind of progressed and became more realistic. And so this one has Diamond Dave made an appearance in it. So I want to read this little excerpt for you. As the afternoon starts to get late, I begin looking for a quiet place to retreat. But not before I stand on the brink. I look to the street, a canal paved for a system to flow. And I have a vision that folks have looted or otherwise withdrawn all forms of metallic wealth, coins, bars, ceramics, and other instruments of man-made concepts of wealth, and are literally pounding it back into the ground, creating a new passageway out of the old for the reel of human potential to flow once again. And across the chasm, I see Diamond Dave, and he's caught up in conversation, over which I hear him laugh and say, people always ask me, what's the end of the world gonna look like? And I always tell them, I think we know what we know when we see it. So, Dave, thanks for being a visionary. Thanks for being our groundhog, and thanks for all that you do.
Well, yes, we do, but we've had a little extra time, so. All right, Barbara Bennett, Bobby Coleman, come to the stage, please. And Dan Brady, come to the stage. Barbara Bennett is somebody I met again at the Collective. See, I started coming to the Collective, about a year ago? About that, I think. And but we haven't really had much conversation, but she's always pretty laughing or, you know, has maybe sometimes a scowl. So I think she has a lot of emotions, and she'll show you so you know how to say hello or, you know. I'm a little bit like that. And somebody looks at me and I'm not looking right. So anyway, Barbara, I'm finally glad I'm going to hear some of your things. So come on up.
So the first time I met David was 1992. I was doing sort of a social work job, and I saw some cool people down the street at an event, and I said, oh, that looks nice. I think I'm going to sort of get into activism. So I went to a Food Not Bombs house, and I met David cooking vegetables in 1992. And so anyway, I wrote this today. As Wavy Davy coined, Diamond Dave is a mind in his own legend. Creation is perfect. Energy, a projection of a magic wand finger that, like the sun, not everyone knows how to pick up on. But David can figure out who can. He doesn't trip. Because balance is tricky, like sharp shard steps on flat-footed streetwalks, randomly, on purpose, like wide sheaths of new grass or miles of shallow inland seas. Because there are rabid cities, and time has already happened. David Forgotten said he was 60 at 59 and 78 at 79 or 77 at 78. and each of his feet lets the other one be in front, like a human bee-in or a political punk hootenanny. He doesn't get oppression. As David likes to quote Jesus, the last shall be the first and the first last. And a new one, don't do what you hate, because mere words are psychedelic. Clean hands that emerge from dirty clothes are children of living light, where you don't have to be a wimp to be a hippie. We are fish with frog's eyes, blinded freedom in the face of ordered insanity. Because sometimes institutions are safe and sane, and the street has bosses and rules. So the only food to eat is the anarchist kind. If you sit down with David at the Revolution Cafe, where as of yet there has not been a revolution, and maybe you're broke or beat or sick or beatific, he might say that if you don't panic, you can keep it organic. So you leave scratching your head, wondering what might happen to organic if I panic.
That was really good, you know. Diamond, somebody likes you, I guess. Next is Bobby Coleman.
Isn't this great? This official recognition of Dave Whitaker. Isn't that fantastic? He was at City Hall, and you know, he got right in the mix there at City Hall with the supervisors, spoke his piece, invited them all up for the photo. You have to see the video. You have to see the video because it's just classic. It's really wonderful. I think it's long overdue. Congratulations, Dave. That's the official thing. And then there's all the wonderful things that have been said by the civic leaders and the poets and the musicians and people that love Dave and have been in the life and civic mix of the city, and also beautiful. So what do I have to add? Just a couple of things. Everyone that I know and love loves Diamond Dave Whitaker. Any day that you're lucky enough to see Dave is a great day. It's one of the great days of your life, every time. So I was thinking about it. Why is that? As a poet, Dave is so full of joy. As an activist, Dave is really dedicated. And as a human being, Dave is genuinely full of love. Now, when you reach a certain elder status, things start to coalesce. And what do you want to do when you love your fellow man and you're full of love? You want to teach. You want to share. And that becomes your life. It's deep within you, and it's what you do. That's what Dave does. He does it with everyone he meets. Like a bumblebee, as Calvin said. He does it with everything he does. He inspires young people intergenerationally like no one else. He broadcasts, spreads the word. Dave is highly intelligent. And at the close of his comments at the Board of Supervisors today, I may be paraphrasing, I'll do the best I can, he said, live and learn, learn to live, this goes on. Man, I love that. So I'm gonna read a short poem. See? Ever the educator, I'm gonna have to learn to get that right. Rocket. So, short poem by Sharada Pate, as edited by my collaborator, Virginia Barrett, who also loves you. The poem is titled Love and Peace. It's an acrostic poem, so the first letter of each line spells out love and peace, in this case, a Dave-crostic poem. Lay your hand in mine. Our hearts are like the trees venturing up to the sky, each with roots of peace. Awake with wonder. We all know no one really lives alone. Deep we hold and feel and grow. People of this planet, equal with our certain gifts, all is of the earth we share, connecting us below, above, each we reach with love. Thank you so much, Dave. Thank you.
I'm just going to take a little bit of time on me and Diamond. I first met him a long time ago, of course, during the Vietnam Wars. And I saw him at the demonstrations. And he was always there, you know. He was always supportive. And he's always talked about vets as well, but he's also talked about the victims as well, which is what I also admire, because that's what we forget as well. I'm a vet, and I never forgot. So, I just want to do a short piece. It's a healing piece. It's called Waiting. I think I read it on the radio just recently, but I think it's appropriate because of what the last line is. This is a healing piece for me, as I said. It's called Waiting. It was the African who turned me on. It was the Aboriginal from Turtle Island that gave me my heart. It was the European that gave me my sorrow. It was the American who sent me to war and tried to keep me ugly. It was the Vietnamese that gave me forgiveness. May I forgive myself? Come back to the hoop. The elders are still waiting. Thank you, Dave. Sometimes the best laid plans don't get laid as well, because I want to make sure I didn't see who I thought. Is there anyone here who's on the list who hasn't spoken tonight? I don't have that checked off. Come, you know, Tio Cambia, is that okay? I mean, this, somebody just came in who's here in a... thanks, sisters. That's great. Well, you never want to step on people's time, you know. You know, time. Well, another person I've met at the Collective, and I'm sort of glad I've met him. He's, what's that? Radio show. Yeah. I'm doing it shorthand. I shouldn't do that sometimes. Well, welcome.
Okay, Mr. Bravo, DJ Bravo. Oh,
DJ Bravo. Yeah, well, Dave did take me on with the Common Thread Collective recently, and it's something about Dave, because I've been around Activists Underground Radio forever, but disconnected from it and collective things for a few years. And Dave saw me at a rally, and he's like, hey, old radio guy, you know, come on. And I was telling him, you know, I haven't been on a radio show, and it's hard to connect with people sometimes, but Dave was just like, you know, come down to my show, I'll get you in. And it was as easy as that. I met Dave for the first time as a young man. I came into this city in 1991 from punk culture and organizing on the streets, and an early friend of mine, James Tracy, introduced me to Dave. They were going to an event at the I Hotel and gave me a lot of history. I've seen him at every radio station I've been around, including the beginning of the micro radio stations after the Battle of Seattle. We were together, San Francisco Liberation Radio. He got my partner in on Radio X. I saw his name on the board and heard him on the radio bringing news audio into KPU. I've also seen Dave in a lot of activist places, including showing up for rally in my old hometown in Harlem, and there's Dave on the street telling me where to go and where Food Not Bombs is and all of that. And I've noticed over time that Dave knows how to bring people together, and he's consistent, and when you see Diamond Dave, you know what he stands for, you know what he does. I don't think he gets swayed by differences in people's personalities and things like that. And the fact that he's out there now is great. I also see him at all the concerts that are out there. In fact, I was at a concert, it was probably last year, if not the year before, a free one in Golden Gate Park, an older performer from before my era in the early 60s, talking about being a beatnik hippie freak. And there's Dave standing in front of me. He walked right up to me and pointed to his chest, and he said, "That's me, a beatnik hippie freak." And I said to myself, yeah, if he said it, he is. So, you know, glad to see Dave getting his tributes while he's here. And the last thing is, he's not like some other people I know that start getting tributes and all of a sudden they're reverent to power and authority and looking down memory lane, but he's still out there making things happen. And so I'm glad to speak.
All right. Thank you, EK. We have somebody who's going to do a very short piece, I hear. So it's Chris, look at me. Is he here? There, coming. Come on up. And then we're going to have Edwin Lindo come up. Thank you. Dave, we have time and people are sort of coming in, and I've you know, Teo Cambio has been very gracious to say that Dave was, well, I'm trying to have him close the show. That, you know, and I would love it if they could, and they're gracious enough to let it happen. So, come.
Okay. All right. Love you, Dave. I'll be real quick with this, except to say that you make us individually and collectively better, and that's a huge accomplishment. Thank you. This is called Diamond Gem in the Rough, and I'm not going to really try to sing it, but I kind of wrote it partially to the tune Song for Woody, the Dylan tune. So it starts off, "Hey, hey, have you heard about Diamond Dave? Cool, hip, rad dude who gave and he gave us the vibe and the beat and the whole worldly love to live all as one tribe with no one above." The rest I'm just going to read. "Who dances and rhymes for revolution, a radical heart-opening evolution, who weaves us together as one big quilt with passion and wisdom that will never wilt, who threads us through Dylan, beatniks, hippies, punks, and rainbows, a tapestry of solidarity, embracing all that shows. Together is truly the only way together to overcome life's throes. Now you're sailing on past 78, still three generations, one idea, love, not hate. Dave, keep weaving our common thread. A rainbow love poem soul can never be dead. Keep letting the light through so we can all shine like you. Aging like fine whiskey, forever young. Your wild open spirit will never be done. Hey, hey, Diamond Dave, thanks for the magic. And remember, don't panic. You are truly organic. Thank you. We love you.
Well, we have had some surprises here, some add-ons. I'm just going to simply introduce the next person who's running for Board of Supervisors, and I've heard him speak, and of course, I'm never easily impressed, but I sort of like his heart. That's a start. So anyway, I give you Edwin Lindo.
There's some beautiful faces out here. I love it. So it's fitting that we're in the library because Diamond Dave is a walking library. If you have a chance to sit with him and talk with him, the knowledge he has goes back so many years that I literally sat down with Diamond Dave for 3.5 hours at Revolution Cafe, and all I could do was listen. And he has more sayings than a thesaurus and a dictionary put together. And what I love, and I remember one of the history lessons he gave me, he said, I started a radio show in the Hate called One Struggle, Many Fronts. KPU. And it's more than just a title of a show. And I keep thinking that it's kind of what we're going through today. It's one struggle with many fronts. And everyone in here is fighting different things. We have the tenants union. We have organizers. We have the radio and the community media. But everyone is able to fight, understanding that we have one struggle that we want to overcome and we want to deal with. The other saying that I love, and Diamond Dave sees me running around, I'm panicking, and he's like, Edwin, don't panic, keep it organic. And I love it, and I just wish I ate more organic foods because I'd probably be healthier. I don't want to take too much of the time. As mentioned, I'm running for District 9 supervisor in the Mission, Bernal Heights, and Portola. And it's the district that I grew up in. And Diamond Dave and my dad actually came to San Francisco around the same time. My dad came here from Nicaragua in 1958, straight to 20th and Cat. And there's history. And there's history that he and my dad can relate to. But it's his birthday. I won't say the age, most of you probably know. But I want us to, no, well, it was last week, but we're celebrating Diamond Dave. And it's never getting closer to the end. It's understanding that we're reimagining ourselves and having dreams for ourselves. And so I thought it was fitting during Black History Month, being in the library, choosing a Langston Hughes poem that I'd love to read for Diamond Dave. And the poem is called, As I Grew Older. It was a long time ago. I have almost forgotten my dream. But it was there then, in front of me, bright like a sun. My dream! And then the wall rose slowly, slowly, between me and my dream. Rose until it touched the sky. The wall, shadow, I am black. I lie down in the shadow, no longer the light of my dream before me. Above me, only the thick wall, only the shadow, my hands, my dark hands. Break through the wall, find my dream. Help me to shatter this darkness, to smash this night, to break this shadow into 1,000 lights of sun, into 1,000 whirling dreams of sun. Diamond Dave, thank you for the light and the sun that you bring to us every day. You inspire me. The first time I met you was in Bernal Heights in front of the Bernal Heights Library. And I was impressed from day one because he said, I still go to City College every single day to take my classes. And he was in classes with friends who I have who are 18 years old. And they know Diamond Dave and says, he helps me any chance he gets and he inspires us in the conversation he brings to class. You are, as I said, a walking library full of knowledge that's always seeking to learn. And as the poem mentioned, you're breaking through that wall of shadow to bring the light to us. So thank you.
Now the guy's a poet too, so, well, you know, poet supervisor. I want to first of all say a little bit about the next person. Yeah, you know who it is. It's Dan Brady, everybody. But I want to say that Dan Brady is one of the other guys who gave me a feature and has been very kind to me at Sacred Grounds. And he's the cohort of this event. And I want to thank him publicly for all the hard work that he's done today, especially because he's the one who's been running around and talking to people. So, brouhaha. All right. So, I want to welcome Dan Brady to the stage.
I'm posing so I can have my mouth close to the mic the way it should be. I'm putting my eyeglasses on. Oh, huh? I have an air guitar. I rent them. They're right over there. Anyway, in case you haven't seen this, this is the one-page poet's guide to all the open mics that I know of in the city, and there's copies distributed laid out way up there. So they don't look like this. The backside actually has all the addresses and phone numbers, so make sure you get a copy that has both sides because somehow the printer didn't do what it's supposed to do. All right, so I met Diamond Dave several times over the years in various places. The Haight Street Fair, I think that was the first place I met him. And it's been a wild and crazy journey ever since. But what I'm about to read is in a sense, born of various things that relate to this. I know you look at the news and you get sick and tired of the news. And I was complaining one day about the news. And my friend said, why don't you write a poem about good news? And I thought about it and thought about it and thought about it. And I think, oh, that's a good plan. So this poem is called Good News. Ahem. I want some good news, people. No, not that born-again, Bible-humping bullpucky you've heard tell of. No, I want good news, and not just for a minute here or there like you get on KPFA fundraisers. No, not what you get on faux news on a slow days. No, by God, I want the real deal. I want a whole work week stuffed full of it, with each bookending weekend fit to bursting. I want to know what it's like to turn on the TV and feel good. I want to feel good every time I think about anything I can think of. I want to be double-dipped, full-up, smeared with good news. I tell you, I want to look at the sky and not think about chemtrail conspiracies. I want to feel the air, wind in my hair without wondering if the toxic crap being carried along in it is from the sewers of India, China's deserts, or Japan's nukes. I want to wake up and turn on NPR to hear wonderful things. Expanding forests, glaciers coming back, along with fish populations, safe cell phones that pay you to use them. Free food being given out, rent reductions running rampant, and the president giving back trillions of dollars to the people, closing Guantanamo, giving up on nuclear power, and bringing the troops home from Iraq, Afghanistan, Yemen, Bahrain, Oman, Egypt, Jordan, Lebanon, Turkey, Iran, Kazakhstan, Balochistan, Turkmenistan, Venezuela, Colombia, Mexico, and the other 123. I want to hear him, thank you, I want to hear him go on about perp walking Bush and his whole suffering asshole crew, placing a stay on every act that rim-jobbing bung-humper ever did, that prisons are being shuttered because millions of people have decided to care for one another, that once godless heathen multinationals are hiring people because they're bringing back rock-solid plan-your-retirement-on-em-God-blessed union jobs back to the good old USA and by the millions. I want to hear about green houses, green cars, green factories, green makeup, green jobs, and a green self-sustaining world. I want to hear how every person entering the job market is saying the same ding-dong thing. Gee, I don't know which one of all these jobs I want. And say, why don't you CEOs take a number, for Christ's sakes? And mind you, I want the good news to go on every frickin' day. I want to hear how millions are giving up cigarettes, taking up Pilates, volunteering for charity work, that everyone has two chickens in every pot, a good, well-built American car in every garage, and by that, I mean one that gets 500 miles per fuel up, takes a 50-mile-an-hour head-on crash with no damage or injury to its passengers, is green, lasts as long as you frickin' want to keep it, and gets free tune-ups, brake jobs, and tires while you own it. I want scenic passenger trains to make a comeback. How scientists are being listened to. Hello? Got global warming on the run, replaced coal, oil, nuclear power, and natural gas, found a way to prevent alcoholism using the cures for cancer that we already have, and have begun terraforming the Earth, for God's sakes. I want to hear day after day of good news, so that by the time the fourth day dawns, I'll have an idea of what life is like in a world that makes sense. I'll be looking forward to the next blessed day, so that I'll be glad to wake up, donate to good causes, of which there'll be thousands, and everyone will be doing very much, thank you. I want all the guns in the world to be turned in, broken up, and melted down to make anything else. I want to hear that every soldier, intel wonk, officer, commander, or insurgent has renounced violence and is getting busy building shelters, planting trees, cleaning beaches, counseling the hopeless, caring for the needy, handing out bread, bringing in water, giving emergency care to the destitute, rescuing cats from trees, and kissing babies. I want to see them all get busy fixing every leaky toilet, broken window, noisy refrigerator, and every ding-blasted pothole in the known universe. That they're working with farmers to grow more food, unlocking potential, opening floodgates, applying bandages, splints, and helping, helping, helping. I want reformed bankers making microloans, giving grants, that defense departments have been shut down, that research and development funding is allocated to make better computers, cars, planes, trains, tractors, shoes, lights, batteries, houses, farms, cities, colleges, schools, basketball, and food courts. I want to hear about a better understanding between religions, races, politicians, and historical enemies, about how borders are being erased, hatreds are evaporating, ignorance giving away, reason running rampant, and every form of love being accepted by everybody, everywhere. By God, I want a week of such good news as people have never, ever, ever, ever had. So, when I go outside and get my free cup of fair trade organic sustainable coffee and an organic everything bagel with wild-caught salmon schmears, everyone will be walking around more than a bit dazed, more than a bit confused, but everyone will be happy, happy, happy. So hallelujah, brothers and sisters, I yearn and dream and pray for such a week. I say I want a week of good news, a flood, an ocean, a sky full of wonders. So that every morning memory of this time, every memory of this horrific, bust-festering butthole, this stupid-ass, jack-shit, fucked-up, universally acclaimed and god-awful world of unholy rank, fulminating, pustulate, oozing scabs is gone. I say I want a week of good news, my friends. Can I have an amen out there? I want to say a week of such good news that glory unbounded. I say I just know we all want to see. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you to Richard.
It really started with Diamond Dave, and it was who he is that got this. Let me see. I was going to say something profound, and of course it left me already. Yeah, it's okay, but it took time. All right. Is there anybody else?
You might want to mention the name James Ellis.
Are you?
Yes, sir. Come forward, Tim. Now.
Oh yes. Oh, the Reverend.
I
Oh, don't do that. Don't do that. All right, man. Oh, good.
Diamond Dave. Thank you, sir. For saving my life, you found me in an alley in 2008, Clarion Alley. You were performing for Litquake. And I saw a man who was moving the crowd, bringing people together. And you invited me down to the radio show and gave me a outlet to give, to have a focus on something other than myself. Introduced me to your co-host, the love of my life, Miss Valerie Ann Francesca Ibarra, Global Val. And I thank you for that too, sir. When you found me, I was fully enclosed. That is to say, half dead, with a focus that was the self-focus. You let me do something else. The world so enamored with neuroses invented by itself. Shall we define it? Self. An invention of the brain. Constantly doing something. Becoming something. Doing anything, really. Rather than see itself for what it is. A loose collection of beliefs, attitudes, and opinions. Which is nothing. Self. Constantly divided. The judge and the judged. One fake thing continually dividing into two in conflict with itself. What does that look like? I must be more generous. I must be less selfish. I must be something. Says a judge acting superior to the content, judged to be inferior. Please. The observer is the observed. Judge is that which it judges. It's all self. So complete change never happens for human. How could it? As the problem pretends to be superior to the problem. So that's not going away any soon time soon, is it? Self. Constantly divided. The judge and the judged. Maybe the question is not who are we or what are we, but where are we? And are we lost in thought? Just looking at it psychologically, what am I? A presence, that which observes. So where am I? Lost in the content, in the thoughts that are observed. Keep looking. At which you may observe in consciousness pretends to be an observer. A very wily, mischievous, ruthless observer, which is thought. And thought's not just observing, thought is judging. Then changing costumes a moment later to be rationalizing, defending itself from attack. From essentially itself. It's a wild thing, thought, freaking out in its cage. Biting its own arm and gently cooing itself to sleep, stroking its pleasurable parts. We'll call that memory. Do you see it? As you see it, with no judgment, that's you. Seeing, and that's love. And you are free. In a way that may be the only freedom available to humanity. Freedom you'll ever need. Free to act outside the programming, the patterns, the petty games thought plays with itself, pretending to be you. Playing at observer reign as you watch it, lost in thought. See it? Yeah? You are found.
I'm glad we had the time. I'm glad you had the time. Thank you, brother.
Yo, Richard. Yo, Dan. Come on up. This would not have happened.
this whole afternoon on this subject proclaimed by the Board of Supervisors, Diamond Dave Day in San Francisco. What the fuck? Who'd imagine it? All have been all the ups and downs of the last since I first appeared here in 1957. Now I wanted to thank everybody for sitting through this, hanging out through this. Everybody, I've heard various takes on various interactions, some of which I had no idea, some of which I've forgotten, some of which refreshed my memory, some of which were a total surprise. But here we are. I thought maybe a few people would come. So thanks for coming, brothers and sisters. Fuck yeah. And I can say in the library now, Diamond David, I can say fuck yeah, in the library. That's good. So I want to bring a trio cambio, at least most of trio cambio, because they'd be two of my favorite three band trio cambio coming up here, sisters. But I want to say Richard, Dan, come on up here. Let's hear it for Richard. Let's hear it for Dan. You two for making this happen. And while they're getting ready, I was going to do a TED talk, but that could be later.
Dime, I just want to say thanks for the praise, but we have to look to the person next to you. They're the ones that also made this happen. People can have ideas, but it takes people. In other words,
that's the key.
You know, it's another coalition that has solidarity to it. Ooh, remember that word.
The key, the anarchy. And here's the poem, how it worked today. Well, take what you need out of this afternoon. Give what you can, where you can, when you can, however you can. In other words, it's about lending a hand. Strangers becoming friends. Friends becoming family. Family becoming community. And community on the move.
That's our movement.
Because, hey, we were brought together for a reason, and that reason is?
Share this.
We love one another. Brought together for a reason, that reason is that we heal one another. Brought together for a reason, that reason is we complement one another. Brought together for a reason, and that reason is that we complete one another. Like what? Yin and yang, left and right, up and down, old and young, man and woman, rock and roll. And here they are, most of Trio Cambio, my house band. Take it away, sisters.
Thank you, Diamond Dave, and everybody. I'm Winsong, and this is Camille Mai. And I met Diamond Dave at Occupy. So the first song I wanted to share was my Occupy song. Sisters, knocking his castle. earth does not belong to us. We belong. We belong to the earth. Enough of this corporate injustice. Enough of this bullshit. Enough of this corporate injustice. Big business has no heart. How can we raise our children ourselves? This torn apart. Why do we occupy? Why do we even try? We try because we gotta. We can try. We can try. And we can win. Standing at the base of the Federal Reserve Bank. Concrete foundation's gonna crack. It's gonna crack, 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 it's gonna crack. Then Crumble Cash Castle is gonna come rumbling, crumbling down. So this next one is called Marching Out, and I wrote it Martin Luther King Day last year. And it's using a lot of chants that we sing on marches as inspiration, carrying the music. Marching out into the barrel of a gun. Marching out into the barrel of a gun.
It takes everyone to change a system.
Marching out into the barrel of a gun.
It takes everyone to change a system.
Which side are you on, friend? Which side are you on? Which side are you on, friend? Which side are you on?
Justice for my brown is justice for us all.
And we will fight for freedom till justice is won. The people united, never be defeated.
The people united,
never be defeated. The people united never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated.
Los pueblos unidos jamás serán vencidos. Los pueblos unidos jamás serán vencidos.
Los pueblos unidos jamás serán vencidos. Los pueblos unidos jamás serán vencidos. We are unstoppable, another world is possible. We are unstoppable, another world is possible. Talking about that good news world. Another world is possible. We are unstoppable,
another world is possible. We are unstoppable, another world
help
is
us
possible.
Out.
We are unstoppable, another world is possible. We are unstoppable, another world is possible. We are unstoppable. 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 Yeah, another world is possible. We are unstoppable. Another world is possible. Marching out into the barrel of a gun. It takes everyone to change the system. Marching out into the barrel of a gun. It takes everyone to change the system. Which side are you on, friends? Which side are you on? Which side are you on, friend? Which side are you on? Justice for my brown is justice for us all. And we will fight for freedom till justice is won.
Yeah, thank you.
So come on, America. Get up on your feet. Time to meet justice. She's marching down the street. So come on, America. Get up on your feet. Time to meet justice. She's marching down the street. Los pueblos unidos jamás serán vencidos. 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 Otra vez. We are unstoppable. Another world is possible. 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 We are unstoppable. Another world is possible.
Thank you. And that's thanks to all of you, really. Yeah, it's up to us. All right. Do we have time for one more?
I think we probably do. Yeah? One more time, Dan? Dan?
One more song? Okay. We're going to close it out with a Sufi song. Yeah. Camille also has a Vietnamese protest song that she wants to share, if that's all right.
Okay, well, then
yeah.
Write it down. So
yeah.
Dan, time. Oh no, no, I'm saying we have the time. You know, I want to leave time.
Diamond Dave Whitaker Day.
Yeah.
After he's done.
On the street, in the street, and if it's not a reunion, revival, resurrection, that spirit, here we be as you see.
Yeah.
There's no exodus, and here we are, fellow human beings, together, right here in the library. The library is that city, in the city, on the planet, in the street. So thanks for coming, brothers and sisters. Take it away, you two.
Sufi one?
We have we do have a time problem because we have to be out by 7:30. It's the law here. We have to be out, and it's already 7:16. And we got to have him talk. So I have to apologize for because I want to hear more.
Please.
But Dave, remember, this isn't Mutiny Radio. The library will kick our butts out at 7:30. Well, but you wanted 15 minutes. We were going to give you.
We'll play while he walks up the stage.
All right, that's a good
All
idea.
I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Ishkala mahabud leila, ishkala mahabud leila. Ishkala mahabud leila, ishkala mahabud leila. Thank you, Diamond Dave. Take it away.
Okay, goddesses galore, sisters glorious. Goddesses galore, sisters glorious. New generation coming along. It's time for us dudes to step back because the sisters are stepping forward. Am I right?
Yeah. That's right.
Sister Winsong and Sister Camille, here they be. But peace, love, and understanding. Pick up what the seeds are planted every day, and they planted these seeds. Take it out with you and keep on going and keep on flowing. Today is the first day of the rest of our life, the first day of the rest of your life. And here we be, as you see. What the fuck? Anyway, saying indeed. So glad everybody came through. Everybody, the spirit said, I think I'll come by here and get it and make things happen. And that's what we're about. The past shakes hands with the future through the now, right now. And then I'll end by saying, dancing sideways down the ribbon of time, the path ahead lit by the echo behind. All I've been through and all I'm looking forward to, and so glad to be here. I'm just amazed. So, Camille. The wind song, take it away. Thanks for coming, brothers and sisters. Oh, and I do got this. This is what the Board of Supervisors, they're if anybody wants to take a look what they have Woo! To say. Woo! What they have to say, I have it right here. They call it Maybe Diamond Dave it. Whitaker Day, right here, and it's all the evening.
All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Ishkala mahabud leila, ishkala mahabud leila. Ishkala mahabud leila, ishkala. To remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Come up on the stage and dance. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you.
Yeah.
All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Ishkala mahabud leila, ishkala mahabud leila. Ishkala mahabud leila, ishkala mahabud leila. Thank you. Arabic.
All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you.
Yeah, come on up.
All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Find the common thread.
David means the water god, the rain god. David, it's Welsh.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just one
the
short announcement.
The breasting gray and the snow will be coming. We're going to lock our little brother outside in his underwear when it snows. And we're going to have fun like Les Enfants du Perdu.
Thank you for playing the tambourine.
Welcome. Pick up after yourselves. We have to leave this room as we found it. That's part of the deal. And I want to thank everybody for coming who's still here to hear it. And some really great stuff happened here tonight. I hope you enjoyed it. And I'm sorry I made that mistake.
No. I'm sorry. I was short with you. Well, just say this was Margaret Cloudfeather.
Margaret Cloudfeather, everybody.